अरे मैं बोल रही यार, तो मार्केट जाना है, मेरी घंटे के दिन तो करने का
ओके,
भी
गुड मॉर्निंग, गुड मॉर्निंग मिस तृप्ति देव मैम एंड प्रोफेसर मिश्रा सर एंड डियर लर्नर्स. सो टुडे आवर टॉपिक इज नेशनल मूवमेंट एंड सोशल ग्रुप वेयर वी स्टडी अबाउट द कंडीशन ऑफ द पीजेंट्स, द वर्किंग क्लास, द कैपिटलिस्ट क्लास एंड द लैंडलॉर्ड्स. So, welcome again, Tripti Deo ma'am, to give us to give us light on this important topics. And those topics are so important. I'm sure students will benefit from this topic huge. And so, little introduction I want to tell about the topic is under the colonial period, the condition of the peasants were so bad. Their condition were deteriorated under the colonial rule because of and we also see the role of the Gandhi, how he helped those peasants in getting out of from those bad condition. And so we will see their different peasant movement in Bihar, the indigo movement, like in Gujarat, in Kheda. So and period wise there are different texts where came, like Ratwari, Zamindari, this system where came. And from this also the condition of the peasant were getting oats day by day. Then we see the condition of the working class and then the capitalist class. So in the 19th century, what we see, the capitalists, those who are the industrialists, were quite weak, and they could not antagonize the colonial government. So in order to facilitate the import of machinery and technician from the Britain, so thus the nationalists took a strong pro-Indian industry position. The industrialists did not support the national movement. So in the 20th century, there was a massive intensification of nationalist sentiment, and which gave a huge mass movement. So the Congress was during that time was a leading organization, and the Gandhi was playing an important role as a leader, and who inspired and guided those mass mobilization. So here the relationship between the Indian capitalist class with the Congress, and particularly with the Gandhi, was generally harmonious. Wherever some leaders of the class spoke a similar anti-colonial language with the Congress used, so there are full support to the Congress that there was a forthcoming, as the Congress did not orient its political and economic agenda in complete favor of the capitalists. So the rise of the nationalist movement we will see, and which emerged the opportunity to capitalist class, and also increased their pressure of government to grant concession. So we will see the time period of 1920, 1930, and also the 1940. This three time period, how important in our national movement. So the big capitalist class generally mainly ambivalent in their support to the Congress, and during this 1940, there became clear that the Congress could come to power, and they openly sided with the Congress and its policies. Next, about the landlords. Le next about the yes, landlords. Landlords were always privileged to the Britishers, because they always they are in a good condition. And because of the landlords, the peasant conditions was very bad. So here I am requesting our Madam Tripti ma'am to please explain each of this topic and start the class. Ma'am, Tripti ma'am, please. प्लीज स्टार्ट
हेलो वन मिनट साइन मैम चंद्रकांति माझी आप अपना स्क्रीन बार बार क्यों शेयर कर रही है डिस्टरबेंस हो रहा है रिसोर्स पर्सन भी वो प्रेजेंट नहीं कर पा रही है प्लीज डोंट डिस्टर्ब अस
चंद्रकांति माझी जो है वो अपना स्क्रीन प्रेजेंटेशन बंद करें स्टॉप प्रेजेंटिंग कीजिए अपना स्क्रीन को आप हाँ निशांत इज दैट ओके
यस मैम
चंद्रकांति माझी आप अपना स्क्रीन मत प्रेजेंट कीजिए आप बस अपना स्क्रीन अपना फोटो और म्यूट रखिए अपना उसको फोन को आप बार बार प्रेजेंट कर रही हैं अपना स्क्रीन तो उसके कारण जो है मेरा स्लाइड इधर उधर हो रहा है आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू प्लीज पुट योर स्क्रीन डोंट शो योर स्क्रीन जस्ट जॉइन द मीटिंग दैट्स इट ओके Nishant, so I'll start. I'll just share my screen right now.
Yes.
And you can give me a green signal whether my screen is visible. And yes, in case yes. anybody joins this, presents their screen, you, again, somebody is presenting their screen, I guess.
No. It's your screen.
Okay. Only. So is my screen visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. Thank you, Nishant. And good morning, everybody. And thank you very much. I'm sorry we had to start the meeting by instructing everybody to do something. But past two lectures have been not been able to record properly because there was some problem with the screen sharing. So technology has its own benefits and it also has its own problems. So we're all dealing with it. So thank you so much for joining. And once again, good morning, everyone. And we welcome our semester four students of MA History. And the topic that we will be discussing, like Dr. Shaheen just mentioned, is a national movement in social groups, right? And this is from your e-resource, MHI09, block 6 is what we will be discussing today. Now, the broad themes of this unit are actually the unit 1 is on the peasantry, 2 is on the working class, 3 is the capitalist class, and the 4 are the landlords. Now, yesterday I had taken up something very, very different, and day before was also very, very different topics. They were administrative and institutional frameworks from the ancient times to the modern period. But today we are looking at a very, very different part of a period of history, and which all of us are more familiar with because it is more closer to our time period. So this is the modern Indian history period, and this is the period where the 19th and the 20th century, when the British colonial rule was there in India. And we will be discussing these four categories of very important categories of Indian social economic fabric, the peasant, working capitalists and landlords. We will be looking at what they are, how are they, what are they doing, how are they dealing with different dynamics of the national movement, what are the responses, reactions. So all of that is something that especially in the middle of the nationalist movement, what are they doing? And after that, before India got its independence, what were the other changes that this category of people were facing and what they were reacting or responding to? So this is what broadly we will be looking at. Let's start with the peasantry, and I'm going to spend the next about half an hour on this particular group of people, the peasantry. And the rest of the other three units, I'll spend about 10 minutes each. I am entirely basing my lecture on your e-resource. So whenever you look at that, you will be easily, you'll be able to easily kind of comprehend and understand this topic. Because there are a lot of debate and discussions and a lot of secondary writings have been written on this period, you can also look at some of the very good books like Bipin Chandra and in fact, Tithankar Roy and, you know, many other historians like Mritula Mukherjee, Aditya Mukherjee, and phenomenal work. Many foreign authors have also done on this period. So if somebody of you, any of you is interested in looking at details of the economic history, you can please look at other sources. In fact, the suggested readings are also given in your e-resource. So let's begin with what's happening to the peasantry. ये जो कृषि वर्ग है इसके साथ और ये कैसे डील कर रहे हैं और इनके साथ क्या हो रहा है ये पूरे पीरियड में. सो बाय एंड लार्ज 19th एंड द 20th सेंचुरी इज व्हाट वी आर गोइंग टू लुक एट. The first important aspect when you discuss the peasantry during the national movement, a very important social group, let's see what was the debate on this relationship between the nationalism and peasantry. Yes, so all of us know about 1757, the Battle of Plassey. Now that triggered from many sections of Indian society, including peasants. So 1757 was a very important landmark in the Indian history, as we see a lot of reactions now coming from different social groups. Peasantry was also one of them. So it wasn't that the Britishers had started to take full control of Indian subcontinent from 1757. 1757 was just a Battle of Plassey, but it did make the people of India understand that the Britishers are not here only for trade. They have other ambitions also. So that kind of triggered for many sections of Indian society some kind of reactions. Not really loud reactions or dominant reactions, but they started thinking about it. So including peasants. So 1857, 100 years after that, was a revolt of the 1857. All of you know about this. The 1857 revolt also saw participation of peasants, tribal leaders, dispossessed zamindars, etc. So after 1857, there was increasing involvement of middle class, modern educated persons in peasant resistance movements. So this is by and large what is happening 1757, 1857 and post 1857. So there was involvement, but there were gradually more involvement of these peasants and tribal leaders, more importantly, the peasants for us for right now. But after 57, particularly the middle class that emerged, the modern educated persons, they started acting as intermediaries between the state and the peasants. That means they helped and supported the peasants in their grievances, making their grievances reach the government, the British government. The nationalist historians pay little attention to the peasant agitation. So again, the debate by and large is between many schools of historians. So the nationalist historians have been considered to pay less attention to the peasant agitation. They consider them as inert masses who were woken up by the nationalist leaders for participation in the nationalist struggle. So nationalist historians have really not paid that much attention to the problems of the peasants. This has generally been observed when history writing started on this particular the national movement. Most writings belong to broad Marxist approach. Now, I'm sure all of you are familiar with what Marxism and Marxist approach is. Now, it was broadly the Marxist approach. Nationalist movement made tremendous impact on peasant consciousness. Marxists think that nationalist movement made tremendous impact on peasant consciousness, but they tend to view the influence of Congress, particularly Gandhi, negative. So the role of Congress again has been seen as not been too much in favor of the peasantry. Okay, and Bipin Chandra's criticism of Congress policy, again you can look at his detailed discussion from your e-resource, that he feels that the Congress policies were not favoring the peasants and their demands. Sumit Sarkar further attests Bipin Chandra's view, again pointing out that Congress did not really push the cause of the peasants, the problems of the peasants. On the other hand, the subaltern historiography dismisses all writings as elitist. They think that writings at this point of time, the nationalists, whatever they are talking about, it's majorly the elitist point of view. Peasants developed independently of the national movement. Subalterns think that the peasants were reacting, they were responding, they were agitating, but they were doing all of this independently. Okay, independently means that they did not really rely on the International Congress, for example, or any particular group. They were reacting, and they were reacting independently. That's what subaltern historiography first have to say. Mridula Mukherjee defended the Congress in her work, stating that they played crucial role in generating peasant movements, particularly after 1918. And she lays importance to Gandhiji and says that Gandhi played an important role. Yeah, and she also emphasizes that it was a multi-class movement, and it was anti-imperialism, the nationalist movement. So therefore, she sees that peasants played a significant role, and Congress played important role in generating peasant movement after 1918. So you can see that, you know, there's a lot of discussion on among the historians on the debate whether how the peasantry was supported, encouraged. Or on the other hand, some of them, like subalterns, think that, you know, nobody was doing anything about them. They were the peasants were dealing and reacting to situations independently. Now let's really come to what were the conditions of peasants under colonialism. What was happening to them? Kya sthiti thi krishi varg ki apniveshik kaal mein? Colonialism ke andar kya unki sthiti thi? So we know that Britishers, when they came in, they came here for commercial. Primarily, their motive was commercial. That's also because majorly because they were colonial masters and they were here to exploit the Indian economy. Now, how do you exploit the economy? You change the economic structures. And in the Indian economic structure, maximum revenue is drawn from land. You know, land is an important source of revenue. I'm talking about the 19th century. Right now, in the modern times, in the contemporary times that we are living, the state has many sources of revenue, many kinds of source, from service sector, from here, from there. But at this point of time, primarily, major source of revenue that was coming to the colonial masters was the land revenue. So the first thing that the Britishers did was they changed this agrarian structure. And they changed to benefit themselves, to benefit the British colonial policies. Okay, so changes were introduced by British in agrarian structure. Pre-colonial rights were deeply disturbed by the new revenue policies. Initially, revenue farming was practiced where the job of collection of revenue was given to the highest bidder. So this was called revenue farming, where a person who would claim that I will give you the maximum revenue, it promised to the state that I will give you the maximum. So it was bidding. So whoever claimed that that person will give highest revenue was given the assignment. Okay, you take this land. So later, zamindari, rayatwari, mahalwari, land revenue system pegged very high level of revenue demands from the peasants. This all resulted in extreme burden of peasants. I think all of us are familiar with all of these land revenue settlement systems that British introduced. Traditional structures replaced by new economic relations, wherein absentee landlords and moneylenders were at the top, and sharecroppers, tenants, and agricultural workers were at the bottom. So you can look at the contrast, you know. The major owner of the land during the Mughal period now is at the bottom of the ladder. Yes, who were at the top of this structure that British created? Absentee landlords. What is this term, absentee landlords? Absentee landlords matlab wo zamindar or landlords jo zameen to unki gaon mein hai par reh rahe hain shahar mein. They're living in urban spaces, but their land and their lords of land with the land which is in the rural areas, the villages. So they're absent from their own land. So that's the reason they're called absentee landlords. So and of course, if you're absent from the land, you how would you know the condition of the land? How would you know and will be sympathetic towards the condition of the peasants? Right. So the top of the ladder that Britishers constructed, the formed. In top of the ladder was these absentee landlords, moneylenders, whom the peasants dreaded. Yes, and at the bottom were these peasants who didn't have land. They were living on their land was taken. Tenants, agricultural workers. So look at the situation in the agrarian setup. There was increase in the number of intermediaries between the state and peasants. There was also decline in agricultural productivity. There was stagnation in agricultural output. There was decrease in per capita availability of food and impoverishment of peasantry. So this is broadly the scenario of the peasants and their community in villages. By 1947, most cultivable land owned by landlords, and especially this was the absentee landlords, and many moneylenders became landlords. So by 1947, by the time India was getting its independence, what was the situation of India, Indian land, Indian agricultural land? Most of this land was in the hands of landlords and these landlords were absentee landlords. They had their unki zameenein jo hain gaon mein thi par wo rahe shehar mein rahe the. Yes, and most of this land was in the hands of moneylenders. Moneylenders ke paas kaise aaya ye zameen? अब पेजेंट जो है उसको पैसा चाहिए, वो अपना लैंड जो है मनी लेंडर को मॉर्गेज कर रहा है, दे दिया उसने उसको, उसको गिरवी रख दिया. अब वो उसको पैसे नहीं वापस दे पाया तो वो अपनी उस गिरफ्त से उठा भी, वो गिरवी से अपना हटा भी नहीं पाया. ही कुंड फ्री हिज लैंड फ्रॉम द मनी लेंडर. सो द मनी लेंडर इज नाउ बिकमिंग द लैंडलॉर्ड. सो बाय 1947 पेजेंट डिड नॉट हैव लैंड्स. जो जमीन को जोत रहा है, द पर्सन हु इज टिलिंग द लैंड इज नॉट द ओनर ऑफ द लैंड. द ओनर ऑफ द लैंड इज विद इन द हैंड्स ऑफ एब्सेंटी लैंडलॉर्ड्स एंड मनी लेंडर्स. सो दिस वाज द कंडीशन ऑफ द इंडियन एग्रीकल्चरल स्ट्रक्चर एंड सेटअप बाय द टाइम 1947, बाय द टाइम वी एंटर 1947. इंक्रीज इन द होल्ड ऑफ यूजरर हु बिकेम क्रूशियल लिंक इन चेन ऑफ कॉलोनियल सरप्लस एक्सट्रैक्शन. यूजरर्स आर पीपल हु लेंड एंड बोरो मनी. अगेन पर्सन हु आप जिससे लेन देन कर सकते हैं पैसा का. Money lenders ensured revenue was paid to the government even at the cost of peasant indebtedness. They lent money to grow commercial crops. Landlords also lent money. Both extracted maximum from the peasants, thereby further impoverishing them. Peasants could not sell his crop to gain anything from his produce. So even if the peasant was producing surplus, agar wo zyada apna produce ho bhi raha hai uska, फिर भी क्या हो रहा है, फिर भी वो अपना प्रोड्यूस बेच नहीं पा रहा है मार्केट में जाके, क्योंकि उसका जो है वो डेट है, डेट मनी लेंडर के पास है, तो वो मनी लेंडर को दिया जा रहा है, मनी लेंडर को दिया जा रहा है. सो द पेजेंट वॉज नेवर एबल टू कम आउट ऑफ दैट डेट एंड द पेजेंट वॉज नेवर एबल टू बेनिफिट फ्रॉम हिज क्रॉप्स एंड दैट लेड टू एंड दैट वॉज ओनली बिकमिंग वर्स एंड दिस पर्टिकुलरली लेड टू द पेजेंट इम्पॉवरिशमेंट. Now we know the condition of the peasants now. What is happening with the peasants and the early nationalist movement? Okay, let's see. After the revolt of 1857, middle class involved in peasants' problems and their agitations were noticeable. They served as intermediaries between peasants and colonial administration, occasionally played role of leaders in the peasant movement. So the middle class really came up in a big way, and they helped the peasants in as an intermediaries between the peasant and the colonial administration. They played important roles. Sometimes they also acted as their leaders, peasant movement leaders. All right, you have to understand the peasants of India are a very humble, simple category of people. At this point of time, the 19th century, they need leaders if their movement has to reach far and wide. And here the middle class of India at that point of time helped the peasants in this entire mobilization of the peasants, right? The early peasant movement, some of the early peasant movements were Indigo Rebellion in Bengal in 1859-60. The Bengali intellectuals here had brought this issue to the notice in the Indian public domain. You must have heard of this famous play by Dinabandhu Mitra in 1860, Neel Darpan, that depicted the oppression and peasant protest in Bengal. Yes, so Pune Sarvajanik Sabha in Bombay, they were the first to associate itself to the cause of peasants. Gopal Krishna Gokhale guided many agitating peasants with drafting memorials and petitions. So you see that by about late 19th century, early peasant movements had started, and not late, but about 1860s or so, and there were many groups that started now looking at the peasants' problem, And just one second, let me just go back, and so we start seeing that the peasants' problem is now. Just one second. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So after 1857, we see that there was a shift in the way that we see the Indigo Rebellion happened, and there was more reaction, and the visibility of peasants increased. The nationalist leaders in Congress in early period, fully aware of peasant problems, criticized colonial administration for burdening peasants with high revenue and the increasing poverty and famine. So now the leaders also started talking about that our peasants are being burdened with revenue. Okay, like for example, Dadabhai Naroji, R.C. Dutt, Bal Gangadhar Tilak. Now these were in Congress leaders who started really talking about that, you know, our peasants are burdened. There is drain of wealth that's happening from India. So we see a lot of these movements now getting support that is beginning with to develop for the peasants. However, broadly, if you look at Congress, it ignored the demand for a permanent fixation of rent and tenure in zamindari areas. Generally, it failed to take a strong anti-lord or pro-peasant stand. Now, you have to understand one thing. The peasants, for the peasants, the landlord was the ruler, right? So more than being distressed by the Britishers, they were at times distressed by the landlord. And here, I'm trying to bring this point that the Congress ignored the demand, for example, to be anti-landlord, to support peasants in anti-landlord movement, or pro-peasant, to take a pro-peasant stand. So here is where, you know, the Congress failed, where it, at this point of time, the Congress members were not sympathetic to the peasants in the way of taking their stand, supporting them, and being anti-landlord, for example. Right. So in Bengal, peasant movements representing majority Muslim peasantry got gradually alienated from the middle class nationalists who took a pro landlord position. So there are differences in the way the landlords are also behaving in different places. It's not that all the landlords were anti and were troublesome to the peasants, but by and large, landlords were becoming problematic for the peasants. Now, gradually, let's look at early phase. We've seen what is happening early phase of nationalism. When the mass nationalism and peasantry, mass nationalism started, especially under the Mahatma Gandhi, when he came in about the second decade of the 20th century, what started happening? Now, with the active involvement of Gandhi, it drastically changed the nature of nationalist association with peasantry. Very important force to be mobilized if Congress had to fight against colonial rule. Now, Gandhi was very clear. He said that if Congress has to succeed, it has to take in cognizance the peasants' problem also. A very important force to be mobilized if Congress had to fight against colonial rule was the peasantry. Yes. So initially, Gandhi, in fact, was involved in Champaran, Bihar, Kheda, Gujarat. We know about these movements that he was involved with the peasants. He provided grounds to disseminate pro-peasant ideology. Yes, he became the leader of masses, and even peasants supported and revered Gandhi. Yeah. So linked national movement to peasantry. So Gandhi was very important in linking the nationalist movement to peasantry. Can you see that? If you see it in Champaran, you see it in Kheda, Gujarat. Yeah. So both these places, peasants had started their struggle on their own. It's not that Gandhi began Kheda. The movement in Kheda or the movement in Champaran, it began with Gandhi. No, that's also wrong to think. Peasants were already protesting in these regions. With Gandhi, the protest became even more stark. It became more dominant. So before Gandhi came in picture, you know, the peasants had already started their struggle in these regions, and they contacted Gandhi for support and leadership. And of course, mobilization of by and large of peasantry during this period was independent of Congress, right? Now, Congress again was not, again, because it was not pro-peasant, the peasants kind of functioned independently in protesting against their problem, against the British rule and for standing for their problems, right? So in Bardoli, the nationalist leadership between 1921 and 1927 undertook the task of generating model peasant movement, linking local peasant discontent with larger problem. Despite protest, government did not listen to their demands. Thus, they decided the non-payment of land revenue in 1927. Nationalist leaders supported this. Finally, a compromise was made and land demand was lowered. So you can see in Bardoli that how the peasant discontent was pushed through protest. And gradually, they, with their protest, they decided that they will not pay tax, will not pay land revenue. And when they decided to do that, they finally, the British conceded to their demands and the demand of land revenue was lowered. So Gandhi involved them in constructive program, village uplift, Charkha Swadeshi. So Gandhi was in, involved the peasants of India in different constructive programs that he had started in the nationalist, under the nationalist movement. He did not want to alienate any section. Now, this is an important point. Gandhi, because he did not want to alienate means that Gandhi did not want to upset any group in terms of going against any group or isolating any group. So Gandhi did not support any class conflict. So that's the reason Gandhi did not support, for example, a conflict between peasant and agricultural workers. Gandhi did not support a conflict between peasant and a zamindar, or a peasant and a landlord, because it was a class struggle. And Gandhi did not want to upset the landlords. Gandhi did not want to upset the zamindars. Gandhi did not want to upset the peasants, because Gandhi believed in mass mobilization. Okay, I hope I'm trying to make this point clear. So Gandhi, yes, but Gandhi did support peasants' conflict or peasants' protest against the British rule, because Gandhi considered British rulers as the final enemy. And Gandhi believed that the whatever conflict is happening within the categories or the social groups of Indian within the Indian subcontinent can be dealt. So Gandhi did not involve in any class conflicts. That's the basic principles of Gandhian nationalist policy that we see generally at this point of time. So rise in prices, high prices of salt, cotton clothes, kerosene, etc., unsettled the peasantry. And the failure of monsoons, absence of large employment, forced labor, eviction from land, etc., created explosive situations for peasantry. So peasantry were also disturbed because of and affected and badly affected because of these several other problems. In Awadh, powerful peasant movements under Baba Ramchandra was initiated. He was arrested. Congress leaders, particularly Nehru, became involved. Okay. Non-cooperation movement provided opportunity to voice their grievances. So now we all know of the non-cooperation movement from 1922, it was called off. But non-cooperation movement provided an opportunity to voice present grievances. We see that Awadh Kisan Sabha affiliated about 330 Kisan Sabhas, and during the non-cooperation movement, these Kisan Sabhas were asked not to offer begar. Begar is the unpaid labor, and refused to cultivate land from which another tenant was evicted. So this was the satyagraha that the non-cooperation that peasants did, the Kisan Sabhas did under the non-cooperation movement. So since 1918, we also see rise of these Kisan Sabhas in many parts of our country. Okay, now coming to civil disobedience movement, it witnessed even larger and more conscious peasant participation. No rent and no revenue campaign in various parts of our country under peasant leaders. So again, with civil disobedience movement, several methods like no rent, no revenue campaign was started under the peasant leaders. We also see emerging leftist trend in Congress. Okay, and this leftist, you understand the left party, right party. So I'm talking about the leftist ideology here. The leftist trend in Congress influenced the growing peasant movement. The new generation of radical leadership under Sahajanand, N.G. Ranga, Sohan Singh Josh, etc., were important in mobilizing the peasants. In Uttar Pradesh, movement against eviction means when you are thrown from your land, evicted from the land. Against eviction, enhancement of rent and forced labor, Local leaders at times resorted to militant actions against landlords in the name of Congress. So there was a lot that's happening, you know, under the civil disobedience movement, and the peasants are becoming more active and more prominent in the nationalist movement. Some Congress leaders like Nehru in UP, Vallabhbhai Patel in Gujarat, they provided peasants and their leaders encouragement. Okay. Peasants provided Congress much needed legitimacy to be a mass party. Now, it's not that Congress was always, few members, I would say, of Congress were helping or encouraging or supporting the peasants. You know, even Congress needed support from peasants. Because if Congress is saying that we are dealing with and we are supporting and standing and representing all the categories, social categories, it needs to involve peasants. It needs to talk about peasants and their problems. So Congress also needed, they also needed legitimacy to be a mass party. Mass party. And therefore, they also needed to involve the peasants. So it wasn't that the peasants were being supported and the Congress leaders were being, some of the Congress leaders were supporting peasants. Even the Congress needed this legitimacy to be a mass party by involving the peasant category, social group in the Indian national movement. All right. Many middle class and upper level Congress leaders, they helped and harnessed peasant mobilization without letting these agitations move into militant channels. So, you know, like I said, our peasants are very humble and simple. So if their energies are not channelized in the proper way, they may turn militant, yes, into militant channels. So what happened at this point of time, there were many Congress leaders who helped to channelize this peasant agitation in a proper way, rather than leaving them and, you know, leaderless, you know, leadershipless. Okay. Unity was not easy to achieve as landlords propped up by colonial government. Yes, they pressurized the peasants to give into their illegal exactions. In Bihar, for example, Swami Sahajanand protected occupancy rights of tenants. He formed Bihar Provincial Kisan Sabha in 1929. In Andhra, from its socialist members and leaders, Congress adopted an agrarian program finally in 1936. Okay, so we see that there are movements and different peasant movements in different parts of India. We saw Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, Bengal, UP. So I've given examples from there. Of course, Gujarat, I've already spoken. Bihar, I've spoken about. So Quit India movement that began under the condition of leadership vacuum. So we know that Quit India movement started, the call was given by Gandhi, but very, very quickly it lost its leadership. Yes, and there was a leadership vacuum. All sections of peasant cutting across caste lines, even many landlords supported, believing that British rule was about to end. So we know that Quit India movement eventually became very violent, and all the leaders were imprisoned, and it became a very haywire movement. And what we saw here was that the peasants and landlords and many, you know, who were distressed by the British colonial rule in general, they started, you know, reacting, and they started supporting they supported the Quit India movement aggressively, and they thought that British rule is now going to come to an end. Yes, later in 1940s, some peasant movements became very militant and radical. Now, with communist, we know that with Russian Revolution also, the communism, philosophy of communism and communist ideology really took up a big leap. And communist-led Bengal Kisan Sabha prepared grounds for the Bahaga movement in 1946, a very important movement among the peasants. National movement helped in raising consciousness among peasantry. They realized that there were certain common interests at all India level. Peasant movement provided strength to anti-imperialist struggles. To promote nationalist ideas among the peasants, nationalist leadership attempted to portray them as a cohesive group above the division of caste, class, and religion. right? So the nationalist leaders were also trying to always show the peasants that they are a group which are a cohesive group in the sense that they were also anti-imperialist. They had a common cause with us, broad nationalist ideas, nationalist. They're also fighting for the broad nationalist cause. So they tried to show them as that kind of a group. But yes, we know that peasants had their own problems, which hardly was being directly pointed out by groups. Yes, and we have already spoken briefly about what the Congress's position was vis-a-vis the peasants. All sections of peasantry in varying measures participated in the nationalist movement, although the participation of upper layer of peasantry was greater. Okay, so we've seen that how I began my explanation with on the peasantry, with the debate that's around the peasantry, that who is supporting peasantry, who is not, the nationalists, the subaltern, the other group of historians, how are the leaders, the Congress, treating peasantry. We also saw what was the condition of peasants. We also saw in my lecture in the past about 20 minutes or so, that what were the how were the peasants involved or not involved in the early phase of nationalist movement, during the proper national movement, the mainstream national movement, the non-cooperation, civil disobedience, Quit India movement. So this is by and large what you must understand when you're discussing the nationalist movement and this social group of peasants when you study from your e-resource. Okay, so let me now quickly go to the next social group that I'll be discussing, which is the working class. Now, the growth of plantation. Now, let's shift our focus on from the peasants to another very important category of the working class. Now, the growth of plantations, coffee plantations, tea plantation, indigo plantation that I'm generally talking about, coal mining, railways and mill industries in 19th century resulted in modern working class. Yes, working class are basically class which is not involved in agriculture. They're non-agricultural groups. Large number of people were employed in non-organized sector in urban areas, like domestic servants and casual workers in the market. So this is also a working class. So working class is a very, very broad category. The modern working class, although derived from agricultural laborers and marginal peasants, was quite different in its position. It was comparatively small in number, concentrated in crucial areas from where emerging modern politics could be influenced. So working conditions of these people, the non-agricultural class that I'm talking about, who are involved in various sectors, organized and unorganized sectors, the conditions were generally very bad, especially of the factory and mill workers, long working hours, low wages, unhygienic conditions at working place, discrimination against women workers, etc. The conditions of plantation workers particularly was very bad. And I think there are phenomenal number of movies that have been made, Bollywood movies that have been made of this period, which talks about the working conditions of the plantation workers and factory workers during the nationalist movement, during this particular period, the 19th and the 20th century. So they were almost like prisoners. Government passed the Factory Act in 1881 and 1891, but these applied mostly to women and children. During early phase of nationalist movement, some social reformers showed interest in improvement of conditions of workers, like Sasipada Banerjee, who was a Brahmo Samaj reformer, S.S. Bengali, and N.M. Lokhandi from Mumbai. These organizations primarily worked for their welfare. They did not have organizational base among workers. So we also see that during the national movement, there were some reformers who were talking about the working class, their conditions, and how it should be elevated. Yes, nationalists were so enamored by industrialism that they did not pay attention to the appalling conditions of workers. Okay, now again, nationalists have been blamed for the fact that they did not pay enough attention to the condition of workers. Okay, Indian National Congress did not mention industrial workers in their early resolutions. Right, extremist stream promptly supported them. So within the Congress also, you know that the Indian National Congress, there were groups, moderates, extremists, revolutionaries, militants, right? Even though moderates did not really support the, to that extent the cause of the working class, the extremist stream promptly supported them. For example, the nationalists quickly extended support to the strike of the signalers of GIP railways in 1899 and appealed to the public to raise funds for the strikers. For moderate nationalists, in case the protests were against Indian industrialists, they did not support the workers and wanted the matters to be resolved internally without the government intervention. Now, it's an important point to pay attention here. The moderate nationalists are looking at the internationalism, internationalist movement from the perspective that the final enemy or the enemy is the British government. Now, if the workers are fighting against an Indian industrialist, because bad conditions, working conditions and all of that are there. Now, the moderates would not support that in a big way, would not support workers in the big way, because they do not want to be against the industrialists. So you have to see that conflicts were happening at many, many levels between workers, nationalists, between workers, industrialists, between workers, Britishers, between industrialists, Britishers, and these nationalists, you know, the nationalist movement, the national movement that was led by many groups, nationalists, extremists, they were trying to balance these groups together, trying to bring all of them together against the colonial rule, the British colonial rule. So therefore, thereby we see that there is a lot of combination of conflicts that is happening. And the moderate nationalists may not support sometimes a matter or a conflict because it is against the social categories which is within the Indian social economic setup. Okay, so let's understand a little bit of this a little more later. During Swadeshi movement, nationalists reached out to workers and involved them in various protests and strikes, especially in foreign-owned companies. Preliminary efforts were made to form trade unions. Temporary organizations of workers were formed. Nationalists such as G.S. Agrakar, B.C. Pal, C.R. Das spoke of pro-labor reforms. The greatest demonstration of workers' nationalist fervor took place in 1908, which was again Bal Gangadhar Tilak's imprisonment. Okay, so we see that Swadeshi movement is when we see the involvement of the workers in the strikes and protests that was organized against the British rule. The First World War impacted the workers majorly. Low wages, tremendous hardships, Russian Revolution, all of this brought new, there was a lot of problem because of low wages and tremendous hardship because of the First World War. However, the Russian Revolution that happened in Russia, that brought in a new consciousness among workers. The International Labour Organization was created for greater politicization of labours and formation of labour organizations. So era of industrial strikes and trade unions began. So if you know a little bit about Russian Revolution, you will see that they supported the workers. In fact, the communist slogan was that the workers of the world unite. So they are addressing the workers of the world. So they are working specifically for the welfare of the workers across the world, across countries. So era of industrial strike and trade unionism really began after the Russian Revolution happened in all parts of the world. 1918 to 1922, there were significant labor movements. All India Trade Union Congress was formed in 1920. Madras Labor Union was formed in 1918. And we also see that the first trade union in India was the Madras Labour Union that was formed in 1918. Now, this trade union specifically had regular membership. Members had to contribute one anna as monthly subscription. So there was participation in supporting mass politics that began. And it became more dominant with the Khilafat movement, the Anti-Rowlatt Act agitation, non-cooperation movement. So there were hundreds of strikes that was seen between 1918 to 21, okay? And even unorganized workers like carters, tramway workers, taxi drivers were involved in their own struggles, right? Labor movement after 1920 registered a decline between 1922 to 26, and this was primarily because of industrial recession that happened. Now, Gandhi had a very different idea about this entire category of people, working class and the capitalist class. Now, he believed in capital-labor relationship, and he considered capitalists as trustees and workers as partners. Both of these categories, social groups of capitalists and workers, working for common public good. Okay, he believed that if there is a conflict on a contentious issue, there should be an amicable settlement, a mutual settlement. And he strongly discouraged any class conflict or role of trade union, according to him. It should not be to agitate, according to him, the trade union role should not be to agitate, but rather work for social and cultural improvements of workers and their families. Okay, so the idea of Gandhi, was very, very different in terms of the way he looked at the working class and the capitalist class, right? Again, because he was working largely against the colonial rule, he did not want to side with either a working class or an industrial class. Like I told you, that he never was absolutely pro-peasant. He supported the peasants in their struggle against the British rule. Yes, but he never supported any class struggle. Similarly here, the idea of Gandhi was capital-labor relationship, which was it was a form of a corporation. It believed in partnership. So when you understand Gandhian movement and the role and of these social groups in the Gandhian movement, and the way Gandhi wants these involve these social groups, you have to understand by first understanding how Gandhi is perceiving these groups, understanding these groups. So communists started having impact on workers from about from after 1926. Particularly, Bombay was affected by the communists. And by 1928, communists and other leftists had acquired an upper hand in All India Trade Union Congress, this organization that was formed in 1920. It participated in anti-Simon agitation, legendary strikes, that especially the Bombay textile workers, the strike lasted for almost 6 months. The eighth session of AITUC happened in 1929, and here is where we see a split within the AITUC, the organization, of course, for different reasons. Although local Congress leaders and activists were supportive of labor agitations, by and large, the central leadership did not do much. Okay, formation of Congress ministries in various provinces in 1937, that somewhere resulted in increasing working class activities. Okay, number of trade unions increased from about 271 in 1936-37 to 562 in 1938-39. To restrict labor militancy, Congress Ministry in Bombay passed Bombay Industrial Dispute Act in 1939. Quit India movement, during this Quit India movement, nationalists involved organized workers all over the country and succeeded to a large extent. In 1945, large number of workers held strikes and demonstrations in support of INA prisoners. In 1946, workers of Bombay turned violent in support of revolt of RIN ratings. So we see that the involvement of working class in 1930s and 40s was phenomenal. And they supported different movements across, and not movements just, but independent strikes and independent demonstrations and independent support they gave to, for example, INA and RIN ratings. Yes. So I'm kind of done with my explanation on working class. I'll quickly move to the next social group, which is the capitalist class. Now, there is a collaboration or a conflict always between the working and the capitalist class. So you'll be able to understand capitalist class. They are the basically capitalist class are the people who have capital, capital in the sense money, and factories, they're owners of factories, and working class are the people who are employees, they are actually employed under these capitalist class. So there's always a relationship of good and conflict and cooperation between them. Now, who were these capitalist class? We must understand that there was again a heated debate among historians on relationship between capitalist class and national movement. Like there has been debate on working class, that how they were treated and all of that. And also, like there was a debate when we started our discussion on peasantry, that how subaltern nationalist historiographers, they believe the peasants were treated and they reacted. Now, Marxist historians generally take a very critical view of the link between Congress and the capitalists. Some other groups of historians like Bipin Chandra, Aditya Mukherjee, Bhagwan Josh, they argue that Indian capitalist class was anti-imperialist and had developed into a conscious collectivity by 1920s and was in the nationalist camp particularly since 1920s. Okay? Dee Tripathi presented a variegated picture of capitalist response to national movement. We'll see through more examples about how why are these arguments being formed by different historians. Some believe that capitalist class was completely involved in the nationalist movement. Some feel that they were sometimes there, capitalist class, they were sometimes anti, sometimes they were pro. So let's see how it's going to be like. There was that steady growth of Indian industries generally that we see since the mid-19th century. By the beginning of the 20th century, Indian capital was dominant in cotton industry. Since the First World War, Indian capitalists made inroads into many sectors, especially the jute industry flourished during the First World War. In the early phase of nationalist movement, Indian businessmen preferred to be on the right side of the ruler for smooth conduct of their business and industry. Yeah, so they maintained close social links with the Britishers. Now, this is a very important point that I want you to pay attention to. That early phase of nationalist movement, the capitalists, the industrialists, they don't want to spoil their business. So they don't want to be on the wrong side of the British rule, in the sense that they don't want be in the bad books of the British rule. So they maintained a harmony and close links, social links with the Britishers. Yes. However, later, through Bombay Association, Ilbert Bill controversy, some prominent Indian capitalists became politically more aware and even participated in big public meetings. So some were also part of Indian National Congress, for example, when it was founded in 1885. Swadeshi movement supported Indian industries. At the height of the movement, cotton mill owners profited enormously because of the demand, high demand of Indian cloth, and this especially during the Swadeshi and the boycott movement. Yes, economic ideology of early nationalists favored a system of independent capitalist development in the country. So we see that though initially in the early phase, the capitalists were with the Britishers because they didn't want their industries to face any, they did not want to face any wrath or any, they didn't want to be in the bad books of the Britishers. Later with Bombay Association and many other industrialists who started supporting the Indian National Congress. In fact, they donated money to the Indian National Congress for the several movements. They started supporting the nationalist movement in the way that the nationalists had drawn the different policies and mechanisms of the national movement. Specifically, the boycott and the Swadeshi and the boycott movement, that had helped the Indian cloth industry to gain some profit. Yeah. By the end of 19th century, some nationalist leaders formed industrial association and organized industrial conferences. For example, M.G. Rana Day founded Industrial Association of Western India in 1890. In Gandhian phase, however, that is about 1919 to 1920s of mass nationalism, various responses from capitalists, various responsible from capitalists, and here I'm including the merchants, the traders, the industrialists. Yes. So during Rowlatt Satyagraha and non-cooperation movement, very few capitalists made donations to Congress. No industrialist, in fact, signed the Satyagraha Pledge. the actual support came from the business class, from small traders and shopkeepers. The industrialists were apprehensive of mass movement and boycott as it might create labor problems in mills. A very, very important point. Why are some industrialists, for example, are not supporting the cause of protest and, you know, boycott? Or were apprehensive about mass movement? Because who will come and work in their factories? It will create labor problems in the mills. So you see that how different categories within the capitalists, the industrialists, merchant traders, were supporting or not supporting for their own reasons. It wasn't that everybody was supporting or everybody was not supporting. You cannot generalize when you're talking about these social groups. Within the social group, for example, capitalists, there were some like shopkeepers and there were traders who supported the non-cooperation movement and movement of Rawlatt Satyagraha. But in these movements, the bigger industrialists did not support. Because if they would support that, who would come, you know, boycott happens and who will come and work in their mills? So please understand that along with the individual's, along with the individual requirement, there was the broader national requirement. And these social groups were reacting on the basis of what was a priority for them. Gradually, there was also disenchantment with the British government. So initially, the industrialists and capitalists who favored British government and wanted to be in good books, they understood that Britishers jo hai, wo hamara bhala to nahi karne wale. You know, they will not, even if we support them and we do not protest against them, aisa nahi hai ki wo hamare liye kaam kar rahe. They are working for their own economy, for their own colonial policies which benefits Britain. So they gradually got fed up from the British government, and that actually led them to support Congress, and they became pro-Congress tilt. So among the some industrialists, so Congress also responded positively by including most of their demands in its list. Support their disobedience movement, civil disobedience movement in early phase. In the second phase of the movement, the capitalists were divided. One group that was led by Tatars openly opposed Congress and sought to derive benefits from imperial government. And others led by Ahmedabad mill owners who sided with the Congress. So during the Quit India movement, you know, they were dual policy of the capitalists. So again, I'm pointing out this point that within the capitalists, there were divisions that were happening. Some were supporting Congress, some were not supporting Congress. That means some were supporting the nationalist cause of being against Britishers, and some were supporting the Britishers in terms of not becoming anti-British because of their own priority needs of their economic, the industrial needs. So due to the ambivalent attitude of Indian capitalist class, you know, it never had a decisive influence on the national politics. So that's why in my entire last 5 minutes or 7 minutes on capitalist class discussion, you must have seen that I'm talking about, you know, wavering support. It's not a constant support that they're giving to the nationalists. We see that sometimes they are, sometimes they're not. Sometimes they behave in a certain way, sometimes they're behaving in another way. So there's an ambivalent attitude, a moving attitude of Indian capitalist class, and therefore they could not be a decisive influence on the nationalist policies, politics. By early 1940s, when it was clear that the colonial rule would end, the capitalists started veering towards Congress, started supporting Congress. In the policy document later, even Congress supported the economic development and capitalist growth in independent India, along with social welfare. So we only see by 1940s, you know, with the Quit India movement coming in, and when most of the social groups thought that Britishers will now go. So that's when aggressively, each and every social group, be it peasant, working class, capitalist class, landlords, in fact, they all started coming close to the Congress and the nationalists and supported them because they thought that now is the time Britishers will leave India and we must support the international movement. Okay. Now, finally, this is my last slide, which discusses very, very briefly about the social group landlords. And there's a lot of discussion because there's a lot of connection between the peasants and the landlords, you know, and in your e-resource, there's details about that. And I, because of limited time, I cannot explain everything. I'm just going to give you five important pointers on which you should just go back to your e-resource and discuss and understand and read on the landlords. So there were, the category of landlords was pretty variegated. Variegated means it was very it was very diverse. And it was very vast, it was very diverse. So landlords were of many kinds, like there were big landlords, medium, small, and even tiny ones, right? By entering into settlement with the zamindaris, the British government tried to extract maximum from the rural agrarian setup. Different land revenue settlements were put into operation across different regions. It both strengthened and even stressed the various landlords. So while I was discussing the peasantry about an hour back, you know, I was talking to you about different land revenue assessments that the Britishers did, right? Now, because of how were they doing it? How were they structuring the agrarian setup with the help of these zamindaris and landlords to start with? Because the British government thought of them as the local rajas, the local heads, the local powerful people of Indian agrarian setup. So you have to understand the relationship that the Britishers, the landlords, which includes the zamindars, talukdars, manilang, many others like that, those and the Brit and the peasants. You have to understand all these three categories, you know, together and the relationship between them to be able to understand the landlord. So please look at it from that perspective. How were the landlords and how were they reacting to or what was their presence in the revolt of 1857 is another thing that you can, another theme that you can study from your resource. And landlords and the early nationalists, landlords and the nationalist movement during 1920s and 30s, okay? And how did the Congress and the left looked at while supporting and taking positions, you know, on the category of landlords? Right. So I'm extremely sorry that I can't spend too much time on this category of landlords. But my entire aim was not also to spend too much time on this category because I spent almost half an hour on the peasants. So I will just take you back on my discussion of the first slide, which is, yeah, the broad themes, the peasants, the working class, and capitalist class and landlords. Please look at it broadly from your e-resource. And my discussion today primarily was on the peasantry, and I think working class also I could discuss in a little detail. I will now hand it over to Shaheen, you know, for her comments, and if there's anything that she would like to, you know, say, and if there's any question. I stopped sharing my screen, and now it's open to whoever wants to go with their screen. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you so much, madam. Thank you so much, ma'am, for throwing light on every aspect of national movement, the peasant class, the working class, the landlords, the capitalist class. And you explained really very nice right from the starting of 1757 to the role of Gandhi, and the period of 1920, the non-cooperation movement, 1930 civil disobedience movement, and the peasant movement, the role of Birsa Munda. And with Gandhi, the movement became more stronger. So in 1857, the revolt, in 1857 revolt, the educated middle class, they did not participate. So after 1857, the educated middle class felt the importance of the condition of the peasant, and they are getting more and more, and the peasant class getting more and more oppressive under the landlord than the Britishers. So, so Gandhi believed in mass rebellion, and the non-cooperation movement that is from 1920 to 1922, the peasant grievance, and the like you told about Kisan Sabha, the Satyagraha, and from 1918 the rise of Kisan Sabha in various parts of India, the civil disobedience movement, the and the different revenue campaign, and also the zamindari system, the rayatwari system, the mahalwari system, and of course in lastly you explained about the landlords who were the main force in the middle of the 19th century. The 1857 revolt actually changed their position. They were not independent powerful, but they gained a huge from colonial government, and because they helped in support of colonial state, so the landlords were did not take interest for the welfare of the nation, and the exploitation and oppression of the peasant continued. So the intensifying peasant movement all over the country against the landlords was being led by the left and the nationalists and the independent peasant leaders, and this seriously undermined their position and convinced that the concerned forces that landlords should be abolished with. So with this I am concluding this topic, and if anybody here like Professor Mishra sir and my colleague Dr. Saqib Hussain, if you want to say something, you are welcome. And dear students, if you have any question, you please write down on chat box. You can directly interact with our ma'am, Kriti ma'am, if you like. Otherwise, if you are comfortable, you can write your question in chat box. Yes, sir. Please.
I have something to say. Right.
Yes, sir. Yes, please. Sir. Go ahead.
Mrs. Kriti Deo.
Yes, sir.
You crossed almost all the points. And thank you very much for your brilliant lecture. You constructed about the peasants, then workers, then capitalist class, then the landlords. And I very much like the comment that the landlords were the collaborators of the British colonial master. Anyhow, the learners must have learned something about these poor classes. But I think one thing we are missing. It's not there in the Eros research of the subject, like we missed about Theocratic State in last class. What is the role of the middle class? The main class, which I mean was the backbone of the Indian nationalist movement, the doctors, teachers, professionals, their role was, I mean, completely neglected in this SLN.
Sure.
So anyhow, it's not our fault. Whatever is there in our SLN, Mrs. Deo, you have put it in a super way. And once again, on behalf of History Faculty, I thank you very much for all your six classes. And in future, we'll welcome you again for GE2 classes,
thank
starting
you,
from 13 July. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Mishra.
Thank you all the members present here.
Yes.
And if the moderator wants, he can end up the session. Nishant, and sign.
I would just like to say something. I think Professor Mishra has raised a very important point about the middle class. And I would just like to say that, yes, the middle class is very, very important, and they should be considered. So while we are looking at the working class, when we are studying our e-resource, maybe we can spend a little time in that particular category only about the middle class, because it is a very important category. Even if the e-resource doesn't mention it, we must be able to spend some time on that also. Thank you, Professor Mishra, for raising that point for us. Thank you. Yes, Shaheen. Yes, Dr. Shaheen. I think you'll have to unmute your, yes.
I'm saying Professor Mishra definitely raised important topic, that the role of middle class is missing from here, from our e-resources, and we definitely took this topic in our e-resources. And thank you so much, ma'am. And here I am requesting students, if they have any questions, please ask ma'am.
I think they did not have any queries.
Okay, so anyway, if they have any, my email and my telephone number is also with them, and they can anyway contact me through that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, now we can conclude this session. Okay, Nishant.